Please stand for the reading of God's holy word. And our scripture reading this morning comes from James chapter 4. And I will be reading verses 7 through 10 from the New King James Version. If everyone is there, would you please say amen?
Amen.
Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you.
Amen.
Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. So then faith cometh by hearing,
and hearing by the word of God.
You may be seated. My subject for this morning is how to overcome temptation. Temptation is a constant experience in every person's life.
Amen.
Every one of us, no matter who we are faced with temptation.
Yes.
Temptation just comes.
Mm-hmm.
And then comes sin. And every sin is preceded by temptation.
Amen.
But you haven't sinned unless you yield to the temptation.
Amen.
Very simply, before you ever sin, you are first tempted.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, if we can figure out how to overcome temptation, we can wipe sin off the face of this earth.
Amen.
Imagine a world without sin, without war, without murder, assault, divorce, immorality, hatred, anger, or arrogance.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine a world without haughtiness or neglect. A world where all sin is eradicated. A world where all sin is gone, eliminated, destroyed, exterminated, removed, and stamped out. And the answer to conquering sin is to conquer the temptation, to deal with the cause of temptation, not the results.
Amen.
And to overcome temptation and to conquer temptation, we must do four things. We must take four steps.
Well.
Verse 7 says, therefore submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, this is a very personal scripture to me.
Amen.
Because in my infancy stage of this spiritual journey, Satan attacked me from all sides to leave God, leave the church, and leave my husband. And sometimes the pressure of the temptation to walk away from God was so severe that I wanted to throw in the towel. And this particular day, I was just about ready to throw in the towel. But I had also prayed, God, if you will help me, I'm determined to obey you. And on that particular day, when I was ready to throw in the towel and walk away from God, walk away from the church, and walk away from my husband, the Holy Spirit reminded me of a prayer that I prayed. He said, you promised me that if I would help you, you were determined to obey me. And in that moment, I cried out, then help me. And James chapter 4 verse 7 became real, because when I cried out, help me, I had just submitted to God.
Amen.
Thus I had resisted the devil, and in that moment he fled. And so the first step to overcoming temptation is to submit yourself to God and resist the devil.
Amen.
But think about how many people complain about how the devil attacks them, and yet God has given us the power to resist the devil. If you would just submit to God, there would be no problem, because the devil is only allowed to come in when you open the door and let him in.
Amen.
When you hear about someone who has gotten into sin, they didn't just fall into sin.
Well,
somewhere in their life, they stopped submitting to God.
Well,
thus, they left the door wide open for Satan to get in, and Satan got a foothold on their life.
Amen.
And so to overcome temptation, you must submit yourself to God and resist the devil. And submit means to put yourself under God, to put yourself under His care, His power, His strength. Submitting to God means yielding to God, yielding to His will, His command, His instructions and laws, His behavior, His word. Submitting is surrendering yourself to God for Him to strengthen you so that you can do exactly what He says.
Amen.
Now, resist, on the other hand, means to take a stand against the devil,
mm-hmm.
to exert the necessary energy and effort that it takes to oppose and defeat the devil and his temptation. Resist means to keep your mind and energy focused on counteracting and conquering the temptation of the devil. And submit and resist are military words that are both urgent and necessary.
Amen.
They are from our military commander, God Himself.
Amen.
And so when temptation strikes, submit yourself to God. Do exactly what your military commander says, because it's God who has the overall plan.
Amen.
And it's God who has all the armament, all the protection, all the reinforcement and firepower at His disposal. And it's God's grace and power that can defeat the enemy. And so to submit yourself to God and His word of command means that when the temptation strikes, you immediately focus your mind on God and His word. You're to turn away from the temptation. You're to push the temptation out of your mind, and you're to begin to think about God, mulling His word over and over again in your mind. You just begin to resist the devil by focusing your mind on God and His word. You persevere in following God's command and resisting the devil. And when you do, the most wonderful thing happens. The devil actually flees and the temptation is gone. Remember now, this is exactly what Christ did when Satan tempted Him in the wilderness. In Luke chapter 4, verse 4, when Satan tempted Jesus, Jesus said to Satan, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God." In verse 8 of Luke chapter 4, when Satan tempted Jesus, Jesus said to Satan, "Get behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and Him only you shall serve." And then in verse 12 of Luke chapter 4, when Satan tempted Jesus, Jesus said to Satan, "It has been written, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." When Satan tempted Jesus in the wilderness, Jesus focused on God and His word. Jesus used the word of God to resist Satan. The critical point is this: you must surrender to God and you must resist the devil. Both acts are required.
Amen.
When the devil or temptation confronts you, you can never defeat Satan and his hordes of evil on your own. You can never defeat Satan by standing and fighting alone.
Amen.
You can never defeat Satan by going your own way. You can never defeat Satan by giving in a little. And you can never defeat Satan by refusing to listen to your commander's words. Under no circumstances are you ever to listen to the enemy's tempting offer, not even once. You're not to even have a conversation with Satan. If you can just picture the temptation, it will move you a long way down the road to defecting, and it will keep you from falling away from God and sinning against God. And so the only way to conquer temptation is to immediately submit yourself to God and to immediately resist the devil and his temptation. Now, you may have to struggle because the images of the temptation will attack you and attack you and attack you. But if you will attack back by rolling God's word over and over in your mind,
yes,
the temptation will flee.
Amen.
Ephesians chapter 6, verse 13 says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, mm-hmm, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. For those of you who haven't tried submitting to God and resisting the devil and his temptation, I want you to know right now that if you would just try God's instruction,
yes,
on how to overcome temptation, you will discover that they actually work.
Amen.
You may have been enslaved by some sin for years,
yes,
but submitting to God and resisting the devil will cause the devil and the temptation to flee.
Hallelujah.
But here's what I want you to get. Because if you've been enslaved by the sin of drugs, alcohol, or illicit sex, or if you've been enslaved by smoking, pornography, overeating, or whatever, the temptation will continue to attack you for days, or maybe even weeks and months. But as a believer, you must remember something. You must remember that you're now in God's army. You are now a soldier under the command of God.
Yes.
Therefore, as a believer, every time the enemy attacks you, you're to submit yourself to God and His word. You're to resist the devil. You're to persevere, and you're to keep on persevering. You're to submit to God and resist the devil,
yes,
and you're to keep on submitting to God and resisting the devil. And you will discover a most wonderful thing. As time passes, as days, weeks, or months go by, the devil and the temptation will flee farther and farther away from you.
Amen.
And the attacks will be fewer and fewer. But even though you will walk more and more victoriously over the devil and his evil, you will never be completely without temptation. But you will walk through life more and more victoriously over evil. You will become more and more triumphant. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 says, be sober, be vigilant, be watchful, because your adversary, the devil, walks around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. As a believer, you're to resist the devil. You're to overcome the evil one. But how? And you overcome Satan and temptation by praying and asking God to deliver you from the evil one. You overcome Satan and temptation by fasting and quoting scripture.
Mm-hmm.
You overcome Satan and temptation by ministering in the name of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
You overcome Satan and temptation by having special sessions of prayer. You overcome Satan and temptation by claiming the name and power of the God of peace. You overcome Satan and temptation by forgiving others.
Mm-hmm.
You overcome Satan and temptation by not giving place to the devil. You overcome Satan and temptation by putting on the whole armor of God.
Amen.
You overcome Satan and temptation by repenting and acknowledging the truth of God's word. You overcome Satan and temptation by resisting the devil.
Yes.
You overcome Satan and temptation by being born again.
Hallelujah.
You overcome Satan and temptation by not fearing. And you overcome Satan and temptation by being faithful to God.
Yes.
And then you do like verse 8 says,
mm-hmm,
draw near to God, and He will draw near to you.
Yes.
Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. And so the second step to overcoming temptation is to draw near to God and repent. But here's the question. How close do you want to get to God?
Wow.
Because basically, you're the one who chooses how much of God you want in your life. Think about what I'm saying, y'all. And just for the record, God is more than eager to draw as close to you as you want Him to be, if you will just let Him.
Amen.
The problem is that some people are afraid to let God get close to them because they think God will make some changes in their life. And they're right. When you allow God to get close to you, the Holy Spirit will make some changes in your life, but they will all be for the better. And so to overcome temptation, you draw near to God and repent. And when you do, you have the greatest privilege in all the world. You have the glorious privilege of approaching God and drawing near to God, the sovereign majesty of the universe, the creator and Lord of the universe. Just think, as a believer, you can approach God and talk to God and share with God anytime and any place, because the door into God's presence is never closed. Amen. But here's what I want you to get, because scripture teaches that the door into God's presence is not only open, but that you're strongly urged and encouraged to walk through that door by drawing near to God. And so it's not only necessary that you draw near to God, it's crucial that you draw near to God. It's urgent that you draw near to God. Because when temptation strikes, it's immediate, unexpected, and fierce. And you may ask, what can I do? What is my hope? And your hope is God. Draw near to God. And the idea is more than just submitting to God. Much more. Drawing near to God means you draw ever so near to God. You get as close to God as you possibly can. Getting right next to Him. Talking to Him. Sharing your every thought, need, and desire with Him. But how do you do this? How do you get near to God? How do you get close to God? And you draw near to God. You get close to God by reading the Word of God, the Holy Bible. Yes. But when temptation strikes, if you don't have access to God's Word, if a Bible isn't available to you, then you review those verses of Scripture that you've memorized over and over in your mind. So memorization is crucial. You draw near to God, you get close to God by prayer, by asking God for His strength and power, His mercy and grace. But your prayer should always be positive, focusing on God and His strength and word, not on the temptation. You keep your mind off the temptation and on God, focusing on God and God alone. You get close to God, you draw as near to God as you possibly can, and then notice God's glorious promise. God will draw near to you. He will embrace you and strengthen you and deliver you. This is exactly what God promises. Psalm 73 verse 28 says, "But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in the Lord God, that I may declare all your works." However, drawing near to God is conditional, because God doesn't allow everyone to draw near to Him. There is a person that God doesn't allow to draw near to Him, and that's the person with unclean, sinful hands, and the person with an impure and wavering heart. And so there are two things you must do before you can draw near to God. You must cleanse your hands, and you must purify your heart, and you must quit wavering between God and temptation, because some people have unclean, sinful hands, and James pulls no punches. He calls them just what they are, sinners. If any of us have unclean hands, if we have touched what God forbids us to touch, not only have we sinned, but we are sinners. And what a terrible title to attach to our names, especially when we call ourselves Christians.
Amen.
Nevertheless, Scripture says that the person who touches when God says not to touch is a sinner. The point is this: before you can approach God, before you can draw near to God, your hands must be cleansed of sin. Otherwise, God will not respond to you. God will not draw near to you unless your hands are cleansed of sin. 1 John chapter 3 verse 3 says, "And everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure." And so to draw near to God, you must purify your heart and you must stop wavering between God and temptation. Because God doesn't allow divided loyalty. Therefore, you can't have a divided loyalty between God and the world. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 21 says, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the Lord's table and of the table of demons. Very simply, you cannot eat from two tables. And God demands total allegiance or absolutely nothing at all. James chapter 1 verse 8 says, he is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Think about what I'm saying. Because if you're that person who's double-minded, if you're that person who tries to follow God some of the time and the world the rest of the time, you cannot draw near to God. God does not accept you, and neither does he draw near to you. Isn't that interesting? That's why you must purify your heart. You must turn your heart completely and totally over to the Lord Jesus Christ. A pure heart, a heart that's totally committed and loyal to Jesus Christ, is the only heart that God will accept and draw near to. The point is this. You can't draw near to God. You can't get close to God unless you have clean hands and a pure heart. And you can't draw near to God unless your heart is totally committed to the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you all getting this?
Amen.
Therefore, you must repent. You must turn away from all sin and draw near to God. Only when you turn away from all sin will God draw near to you and make himself available to you at all times. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 22 says, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. The point I want you to see is that the believer who has the right to draw near to God is the believer who walks in open fellowship and communion with God. The believer who has the right to draw near to God is the believer who keeps his hands clean and his heart pure. And the believer who has the right to draw near to God is the believer who walks in prayer all day long, confessing and keeping yourself pure. Thus, you're the believer whom God loves. You're the believer that God is always drawing near to. And you're the believer who's always fellowshipping and communing with God and who walks triumphantly over temptation. The believer who's always drawing near to God is the believer who's victorious over the temptations and trials of life. You're God's great victor, and you're the one whom God loves ever so much. So come near to God, and God will come near to you. But for God to come near to you, you must clean all the sin out of your life, because it's impossible to follow God and the world at the same time. And you need to make your thinking pure. And the only way to think clearly is to keep sin out of your life. So say a quiet yes to God, and he'll be there in no time at all to help you. Quit dabbling in sin. Purify your inner life and quit playing the field. And do like verse 9 says, lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. So how can you overcome temptation? And the third step to overcoming temptation is to be enduring and deeply and mournfully concerned. In other words, be sad, cry, and weep. Change your laughter into crying. Change your joy into sadness. And this is a descriptive verse. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. The King James Version reads, be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. And the word for be afflicted means to endure toils, to discipline yourself, to voluntarily abstain. You voluntarily withdraw or refrain from something. The picture is this. When temptation strikes, it isn't time to be laughing and joking around. It isn't time to be lighthearted. It isn't time to be complacent and at ease, or to be teasing and unconcerned, or to be comfortable and lying around. Temptation is affliction. Therefore, it's time to be disciplined and to control the comforts and joys of life. Temptation is a time for rigorous warfare. It's time for battle and the discipline and endurance of battle. Yeah. In fact, the conflict of temptation is usually immediate and unexpected. Therefore, you must immediately drop whatever you're doing. You must immediately stop the laughter, the comforts, or the joy of the moment and focus on getting near to God. Amen. Your heart must mourn and weep under the heaviness of temptation and its attacks. Your heart must mourn and weep before God, asking and begging for His strength and deliverance. And you must ask and beg for fear you may disappoint Him and cut the heart of Christ. This is the way to overcome temptation. This is the third step to victory, enduring and being deeply and mournfully concerned. And so as soon as you're tempted, you must immediately drop whatever you were doing. You must immediately drop the activity, the comfort, the joy, or the laughter, and you must immediately discipline yourself. You must focus your heart and mind on God and draw near to God. You must get serious. You must mourn and weep, and you must ask and beg God to help you through the temptation. And when you take temptation this seriously, God will hear your cry and He will deliver and save you. So it's all right if you hit rock bottom and cry your eyes out, because fun and games are over. It's time to get serious, really serious, and it's time to do like verse 10 says, humble yourselves in the sight of God, in the sight of the Lord, and He will lift you up. And so the fourth step to overcoming temptation is to humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, because God sees you at all times. God sees you even when you're tempted. But when you are tempted, what God must not see is your continuing in the activity. God must not see you continuing in the comfort, the laughter, or the joy of the moment. What God must see is your drawing near to Him, mourning and crying for deliverance. God must not see a self-sufficient spirit. God must not see a spirit that overlooks calling on Him. God must not see a spirit that ignores His word, and God must not see a spirit that faces temptation on its own, ignoring God, not even thinking about God and His word and strength. What God must see is you humbly coming into His presence, calling and depending upon Him for strength and wisdom to overcome the temptation. God must not see you looking at the temptation, picturing how attractive and enticing it is. God must not see you reveling in the thoughts of the temptation, picturing how nice it would be. And God must not see you dallying around, thinking and picturing the attractiveness of any temptation, be it the taste of a second helping of food, or a second look at an attractive man or a good looking woman, or any other enticing attraction. What God must see is you casting down every imagination, bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 verse 5 says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Amen. Imagine, every thought is to be captured and made obedient to Christ. Think about what this does to so much television, reading, and loose moments of wandering thoughts and undisciplined daydreaming. What you must always remember is that spiritual warfare is fought in the spirit and in the mind. It's fought at the very core of your heart and mind. Therefore, you must commit your heart and mind to focus totally on Christ and things that are true and honest and just, things that are pure and lovely and of good report, things that are virtuous and praiseworthy. Philippians 4 and 8 says, meditate on these things. To gain an unbroken commitment and fellowship with God, to draw near to God, to overcome temptation, you must struggle. You must subject your every thought to Christ. But even for the best of us, it will take years to gain such commitment and discipline of the spirit and mind. And it can be done, and it must be done by the Spirit of God for the sake of Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
Unbroken communion and fellowship with Christ is what God is after. It's the very reason He created us and has now saved us. The point is this. When you're tempted, if you will humble yourself in the sight of God, God will lift you up.
Amen.
God will meet your need. God will give you whatever you need. And He will deliver you from the onslaught of temptation. But only when you realize your own ignorance can you ask God for His guidance. Only when you realize your own poverty and the things that matter will you pray for the riches of God's grace. Only when you realize your weakness in the necessary things will you come to draw on your strength in God. Only when you realize that you can't cope with life by yourself will you kneel before the Lord of all good life. Only when you realize your own sin will you realize your need of a Savior and the forgiveness of God.
Wow.
Romans chapter 12 verse 3 says, "For I say through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one of us a measure of faith."
Amen.
Many people want much from God. They want to be leaders. They want to be given lots of responsibilities. But God says if you will humble yourself before Him, He will lift you up. The idea is that you are not to exalt yourself, and neither are you to force yourself into a position that God didn't put you in.
Amen.
Now, that doesn't mean you can't have big dreams or take steps to prepare for your future, but it does mean that you must totally trust God with your life. So how do you overcome temptation? You submit to God and resist the devil. How do you overcome temptation? You draw near to God and repent.
Yeah.
But you must have clean hands and a pure heart. That is, you must live a pure life. You must turn from your sin and turn to God. You must have a changed mind, a change of direction, and a changed heart. How do you overcome temptation? You discipline yourself, and you're deeply and mournfully concerned. You cry, you mourn, you weep. How do you overcome temptation? You humble yourself before God, and humility before God will be followed by His lifting you up.
Amen.
This is how you overcome temptation. And remember, you haven't sinned until you yield to the temptation. Amen?
Amen.
Can we praise God for His word this morning?
Amen.
We have no reason to be tempted any longer.